Today, we will be focusing our attention on the report Justice at Risk, authored by Joanna Shepherd, one of our panelists today. So we're going to let her start the conversation. I've talked to all the panelists. We're going to try to keep this as interactive as possible because I think that's what's really interesting and fun about panels like this, is to see some real interaction and get a chance to understand how different perspectives might respond to one another. So I've asked them all to keep their opening remarks fairly short, and then we'll move into a bigger discussion among the panelists. We're going to start with Joanna Shepherd, who's an associate professor of law at Emory University in Atlanta, working primarily in the field of law and economics, and the author of Justice at Risk. So I'm going to turn it over.
Great. Well, thank you to ACS first for having me here today, and also for sponsoring a lot of the research that went into this study. So this study focuses on the relationship between interest group money and the votes judges cast in various types of cases. Before I turn to the study specifically, let me give you a little bit of background on the problem that motivated it. Almost 90% of state appellate judges must regularly be reelected by voters. Despite various reforms aimed at protecting judges from electoral pressures, judicial elections have become increasingly politicized and expensive in recent years. Big money is spent on these elections. Throughout the 1990s, candidates raised about $83 million in state Supreme Court elections, but in the last 10 years, 2000 to 2009, sorry, not last 10, but between 2000 and 2009, candidates raised over $207 million. That's almost a tripling of the money that's spent in these elections. Candidates running in partisan elections now routinely raise over $1.5 million for each race. We've also seen a huge upsurge in spending on TV advertising in the last decade. Over $90 million was spent between 2000 and 2009. Interest groups routinely dominate this spending. Business groups and lawyers groups, which are composed primarily of the plaintiff's bar, each contributed about $60 million directly to judicial campaigns in the last decade. Other interest groups, such as unions, spend very little. However, business groups have overwhelmingly dominated interest group spending on TV advertising. They spend significantly more than any other interest group, including lawyers groups. The critical role of money in winning judicial elections may give wealthy interest groups the opportunity to influence judges. In fact, surveys with judges reveal that they too are concerned about this problem. 80% of judges believe that with campaign contributions, interest groups are trying to use the courts to shape policy. And 46% of judges believe that campaign contributions have at least a little bit of influence on their own decisions. Several judges have also openly admitted to the pressure they feel. For example, Ohio Supreme Court Justice Paul Pfeiffer told the New York Times recently, "I never felt so much like a hooker down by the bus station as I did in a judicial race. Everyone," pause. Everyone interested in contributing has very specific interests. They mean to be buying a vote. A growing body of empirical studies confirms that we have reason to be worried. Many empirical studies to date have found that judges do tend to favor campaign contributors in their decisions. Although these studies present very convincing results, they all use outdated data from the 1995 to 1998 period. But circumstances have clearly changed since that period in the late 90s. The amount of money spent on elections has nearly tripled, and several important court cases, such as Citizens United, have dramatically changed the landscape of judicial elections. Thus, new analyses using current data are critical to establish the current relationship between money and judicial decision making. In response to this need, ACS has sponsored an objective effort to compile current data. Over the past year, a team of independent researchers and academics have coded data on more than 2,300 business-related state Supreme Court cases from all 50 states during the years 2010 to 2012. We augmented this data by adding over 175,000 campaign contribution records and many other case and state-specific variables. Before I turn to the results, let me take a moment to explain why we focused on business cases and contributions from pro-business groups. Business groups spend far more money on judicial elections than any other interest group. They spend more than 10 times as much money as unions, and they spend significantly more on TV advertising than lawyers groups. So although influence from any interest group on judges voting would be concerning, we chose to look where there was the most money and, as a result, the most likely influence. Some of the studies using the data from the earlier 90s, including some of my own studies, have confirmed that money from other interest groups also has a relationship with judicial voting. Let me also note that we recognize that there are two ways that interest group money can affect case outcomes. First, the money can determine which judges get elected, and obviously which judges get elected helps determine case outcomes. Alternatively, the money could influence judges on the bench to vote in a specific way in hopes of getting future campaign contributions. Although some of the earlier empirical studies I've mentioned were able to show that both of these pathways play some role in the relationship between money and voting, we are less concerned about the specific pathway in this study. Regardless of the pathway, interest group money is affecting case outcomes. And if we think it is the law that should determine these outcomes and not money, then this should be concerning. Now to the results of our study. We found a statistically significant relationship between business group contributions and judicial voting. The more campaign contributions the judges receive, the more likely they are to vote for business litigants appearing before them in court. For example, we found that a judge who receives half of his contributions from business groups would be expected to vote in favor of business interests almost two-thirds of the time. However, we found this relationship between business contributions and judges voting only in partisan and nonpartisan elections. We found no statistically significant relationship between money and voting in retention election systems. The data also reveals that the relationship between business contributions and judges voting is stronger among Democratic judges than Republican judges. Although surprising, we suspect this is because Republican judges tend to be more ideologically predisposed to favor business interests in the first place. They're starting at a higher baseline, so additional money probably has less of an additional influence on them. Finally, because the landscape of judicial elections has changed so much in the past decade, we compared the relationship between business contributions and judges voting in the 2010 to 2012 period to the 1995 to 1998 period using the earlier data. Although we found statistically significant relationships between money and voting in both periods, the relationship is much stronger and larger in the 2010 to 2012 period. So to sum up, all signs point towards judicial elections continuing to become more political and more expensive. Our results show that reforms are necessary to protect justice from the destructive role of money in judicial elections. I'll stop there.
Great, thank you. We're gonna turn to Professor Jeremy Kidd, Assistant Professor of Law at Mercer University, Walter George School of Law, teaches in the area of law and economics, commercial and business law.
Great. Well, thanks, Gracias, for having me here. So I haven't seen all of the data. I mean, I received this about when it was released to the public, so I've had as much time to digest it as anyone else, which is very little time at all. So I can't comment on the reliability of the results or anything like that. It's okay. None of you would probably be interested in it. Myself on the particular methodology or why you chose that variable, why you chose the other one. I have some questions about that, but generally, I trust Joanna. Joanna is a very good researcher. Even when I disagree with the conclusions she reaches, I never doubt that she's done it the right way. So barring some glaringly obvious problem, which I wouldn't suspect, I trust the results. And that bears mentioning that anytime you're dealing with empirical questions, you have to remember it's virtually impossible. I tend to think it is impossible, but I'm going to hedge my bets just a little. Virtually impossible to conduct a perfect empirical study. That creature just does not exist. It's like a unicorn. I guess I shouldn't say that there ain't anyone from North Korea in the audience. The primary question I always ask when it comes to an empirical study, unless I can see something that's just obviously wrong, which I don't hear, is whether or not the study, the empirical results, seem to coincide with some plausible theory. And here I think this is very consistent with a plausible theory. I deal a lot with rent seeking in my own research. I'm a public choice scholar, so that's most of what I do. And the idea of rent-seeking in the judiciary seems perfectly plausible to me. Most of the literature on rent-seeking focuses on the executive and the legislative branch. And I think it's a failure of those of us in the law and econ profession that we've, for the most part, left judicial rent-seeking alone. We haven't dealt much with it. But the theory of rent-seeking says any time that a body has power to dole out goodies, whatever you define those to be, there will be plethora of groups seeking to obtain those goodies. And the courts have always had that power. And so the existence of judicial rent seeking shouldn't come as a surprise to anyone. Maybe the question we should be asking is why we haven't noticed rent seeking in the past. Maybe it is because the judiciary really is, or at least used to be, the least dangerous branch, as the Federalist Papers talk about. Todd Zwicky, a colleague, a friend of Joanna's and mine, has a theory about the emergence of stare decisis in the late 1800s and how that created incentives for judicial rescue. But trust me, that's not a debate you want to have. It's not a discussion you want to get into right now. So the idea of judicial rent seeking seems perfectly plausible and reasonable. And the results seem to show that in recent decades, corporations have increased their rent seeking efforts. And that is a fascinating and potentially very troublesome result. But the one question that I think we ought to be willing to ask ourselves is why? Right? If you think it's a terrible thing, I think that's fine. That's a perfectly legitimate way to go about thinking about this. It's an awful thing. But at least ask yourself, why? Why the increase in rent-seeking from the past two decades? Has there been some fundamental change in the nature of corporations that has turned them to the dark side of rent-seeking only in that time period? I think we'd all agree that corporations have been rent-seeking, have been seeking goodies from government for a lot longer than the last two decades. Maybe it was Citizens United, maybe it was other court cases we've seen in the last two decades that have opened the spigot. But it's at least worth considering that perhaps the change came from the judiciary. As the judiciary becomes more active, becomes more involved in shaping policy itself, that opens up more avenues for rent seeking. Now, it's okay to think that, it's fine if that's, if you've made the choice and you have the opinion that that is a preferable avenue for the judiciary, that the judiciary ought to be more involved. But you ought to be aware that when the judiciary becomes more involved, it does open the door to more rent seeking. Right? It is the natural consequence of increasing the power of the judiciary. So we need to keep that in mind as we search for solutions. All right, now back to the study. Just to finish up my introductory comment, I just have a few words of caution. And they are words of caution generally about empirical results, what empirical studies can and cannot prove. They can help us to reach conclusions, but that final step of, in many cases, simply isn't in the data. You have to use that based on your own personal norms. First, corporations are obviously not the only group that are engaged in rent-seeking. The study makes that clear. There are a lot of other groups that are engaged in rent-seeking. Not all of it happens through contributions to candidates. There are a lot of ways that you can seek rents from the judiciary. And nothing in the empirical results can tell us exactly where the optimal point is. Right? Unless you believe that corporations are the root of all evil in the world, or unless you believe that corporations are the source of all good, there will not be a corner solution. In that's mathematical terms for basically there is no extreme. We don't want all punishment of corporations, and we don't want all reward of corporations. The optimal point is somewhere in the middle. And knowing that we have shifted in the past two decades tells us nothing. This is not a derogatory comment, by the way. It doesn't tell us anything about whether we have moved towards in a good direction or in a bad direction. Now, everyone in this room, I think I have a pretty good idea what the ACS, the general ACS membership would view that this is probably a good direction. I just want to point out that the empirical study doesn't prove that. That's a step you have to take based on your own opinion. There's nothing in the data, and I don't think there's any empirical study you could do that could prove where that optimal point is. That's going to have to be based on an opinion. Just understand that moving forward. The second is that the empirical results here don't tell us a whole lot about causation. And Joanna's very careful in the report, and rightfully so, to avoid saying that that there's any causal relationship here. Talks about there being a statistically significant relationship. And that's the scientific way of addressing it let me put it this way. The report talks about the two pathways, right? Does the money fall, or do decisions follow the money, or do money follow the decisions? Do we elect certain types of judges who then rule a certain way, or do we elect judges and they are swayed by the allure of money? Right? Which of those is the answer? Now, Joanna thinks that it's not a big deal that both of those are bad, but you have to understand there is at least a plausible explanation for one of those two to be not quite as bad as the other one. Right? If people are simply giving to judges who believe a certain way, I'm not willing to say that those judges who believe that corporations are entitled to more deference are evil people or are somehow intending to destroy our judicial system. They may be wrong. But that's a different thing than attempting to buy votes. From an ethical perspective, from a moral perspective, those are entirely separate questions. Right? One is more dangerous than the other, and this cannot tell us which one it is. And Joanna's very clear that it's not attempting to, and it's very tricky to determine causation. When I was in graduate school for economics, we learned about time series tests, and you can do tests for causation. I'm actually kind of interested in doing a test for causation myself, but I can get it before anyone else does. But that's what you have to do before you can actually infer causation. So that's the second word of caution. We don't know anything about causation here. We know about statistical relationships, we know about correlation, we know almost nothing about causation. And the last thing is that in crafting policy responses to this and other studies, we should be aware, again, that rent-seeking, that the power draws rent-seeking, not the other way around. As the judiciary becomes more involved in shaping policy, in shaping society, rent-seeking will increase. There's a good argument to be made that judicial contributions, or judicial election contributions, are the most transparent form of rent-seeking. If all we focus on is the campaign contributions, we may eliminate the most transparent form of judicial rent-seeking, only to drive the rent-seeking into less transparent, more opaque, and therefore more insidious forms of rent-seeking. Now, I agree with the report, and I agree with the general proposition that it is a problem when the public starts losing faith in the judiciary. It's all the judiciary has. My only point is that we ought to be just as concerned with the actual integrity of the system as we are with the system's public support. And so as we move forward, we need to be very careful that we don't cut off one avenue of rent-seeking only to funnel all that money and all that effort into areas that we can't track. So if there are, anyway, I'll leave it at that for now.
Thank you. We're going to move to Justice Marilyn Kelly. She currently serves as the Distinguished Jurist in Residence at Wayne State University Law School. After retiring this year from the Supreme Court of Michigan, she served 16 years on the Supreme Court, two of those as Chief Justice, and most recently has co-chaired Michigan's Judicial Selection Task Force to examine potential reforms.
Thank you. I'm going to take a little different approach here. I want to start first by talking to you a little about what's happening in my state and tell you a little about my own personal experience with it. Basically, my position is that Michigan has been swamped by a toxic wave of dark money, much greater than is happening in other states. I think Mr. Kidd refers to this as rent-seeking. I find that an interesting expression. I wouldn't call it a euphemism, sir, because in my opinion, we're talking about influence peddling and campaign purchasing. And that's what I think has been happening in our state. But let me give you a few examples that will tend to support what you saw in Justice at Risk. If I could have the first screen. You'll notice this summary of Michigan campaign spending, and this was Supreme Court spending, during the period 84 to 2012. You'll notice if you run your eye to the end of that top group of figures, you'll have a summary for 84 to 98. And that summary shows you that campaign committees, now those are the committees, that's the money that was collected by candidates themselves. It's significant to know what that is because those monies were all reported according to campaign finance laws. The amount of money, the name of the donor, and all of that was disclosed and disclosed to the public before the election ever took place. That was about $12.5 million. Independent expenditures over that period was far less, about $1.3 million. The independent expenditures came from non-campaign committees, like political parties, labor unions, the Chamber of Commerce. The average spend on each candidate was about $768,000. Now jump to the next 14-year period, the period from 98 to 2012, campaign committees went up from 12.5 to $19.1 million spent. The amount independent groups spent went up from $1.3 million to $7.4 million, far more significant rise. But what's interesting is we have another category here that we're calling electioneering TV ads that only began, you'll notice, in the year 2000, and that went by the end of the period to $34.7 million. This money came from groups that are frequently called social welfare groups. These are issue ads. These are ads from groups that the internal, like 501c4 groups, that the Internal Revenue Code does not require reveal the name of their donors. These figures were compiled by the Michigan Campaign Finance Committee in Michigan, which is headed by Rich Robinson, the executive director. I think these statistics are highly credible. And if you go to the next screen, you'll get a graph there that'll also tend to explain this to you some. You can see that the amount of spending from 84 to 2012 went up from about $1.2 million for one of these campaigns to almost $19 million. And not only that, the amount spent by TV issue ads and independent expenditures far outstripped the amount spent by campaign committees, which in 84 and as far as into 94 were solely were the sole means of financing these committees. I think the significance of this is grave. It means that independent groups that don't have to disclose who they are able to have an influence on campaign results and, of course, who gets elected. That, in addition to the fear that they have an influence on the people who do get elected and how they vote. And then the last thing, and Mr. Kidd referred to it, is even if every single judge who is the recipient of this kind of money and gets elected is impervious to the fact of it and votes totally independently and totally without bias, the public has a hard time believing that happens. The public doesn't believe it. Statistics of various surveys that have been done tend to show that the overwhelming percentage, 88 to 90% of both Democrats and Republicans, believe that these candidates are influenced by the money and vote according to the money they get. And for that reason, I call it dark money, it's not disclosed, and toxic because it has a terrible influence on the general reputation of the judiciary, on the strength and viability of that whole segment of government. I'll stop there and be glad to talk more later.
Thank you. Finally, we have Justice David Wiggins. The Iowa Supreme Court served on the Iowa Supreme Court for 10 years, won retention in the state of Iowa last fall, was appointed by Governor Tom Vilsack, and currently chairs the Judicial Nominating Commission for the state of Iowa as well.
Thank you. I do want to thank ACS for having me, but you know, I read the report and I'm trying to figure out why am I here, because if you read the report, it says retention elections don't get affected by business. So we're a retention state. We have a, quote, merit selection modified Missouri plan where the governor appoints and then every so often you're on the ballot for retention. But my experience, at least after we decided a same-sex marriage case back in April 2009, is horrific. We decided a case, and three of the justices who were on the ballot were voted out, and they lost by 8 points. Now, a normal retention election in Iowa, the judge gets 75%. In fact, the first time I ran, I got 75% because 10 or 15% always vote no, you know, and then you have to just deal with the rest. The results were devastating. We lost three justices at one time. I was the next person up, and I was on the ballot with the other three who got appointed to take their place. They end up with 75%. I ended up with 54%, so I survived. And it wasn't because of me, I don't think, and it wasn't because of what I stood for, because I didn't campaign just like the other three justices didn't campaign. But in both instances, there was out-of-state money that was unidentifiable, that nobody knows where it came from. In fact, I saw, getting on the plane this week, that one of the presidential candidates have filed a complaint with the Federal Election Committee and the Iowa Election Committee about the undisclosed money in those races. Because what brought it about in the 2010 election was, you know, we're the first caucus state and all the presidential candidates try to get there. So it turns out Newt Gingrich and some other people started raising money. I think that Governor Jindal and Rick Santorum are running again because they campaigned against me. They were in Iowa, running around Iowa, campaigning against me. So I expect they're going to be out there running again. But all of that caused me to try to figure out what the heck's going on. I mean, I didn't sign up to run an election. I didn't sign up to raise money. I made a conscious effort not to in the last election. But what's happening and why is it happening? And I started reading a lot of stuff and looking a lot of stuff, and I'm not an expert, I'm not a scientist or an economist or things like that. But it occurred to me that what happens in these situations, in a retention type situation, is that somebody doesn't like a decision, and it's usually not a business decision. The retention elections are usually driven by political decisions. And you could go back to the 1980s, Ruth Byrd and the California Supreme Court, and two of her fellow justices were not retained because they never could sign on to a death penalty case. In the 90s, Penny White was defeated in Tennessee because of a death penalty case she was involved in. There was another justice, and I forget his name, in Nebraska in the 90s, who was also defeated in a retention election because of a term limit decision that was written in that state. And then there's the three justices from Iowa based upon the same-sex marriage case. And what bothers me is that in a retention state, you cannot really buy a justice like you can in a direct election like in Michigan or whatever, if you can buy a justice or buy a judge. But you can sure intimidate them. You can sure have them think about before they vote. You could sort of shape the court if you can get more than one off at one time. There's a whole lot of things that could happen. But when you think about why we started this country with fair and impartial courts, it really came, you know, if you go back to the Declaration of Independence, and in that, you know, it was just an indictment against King George III. And what two lines contained in the Declaration of Independence make it clear that one of the indictments against the king was he has obstructed the administration of justice by refusing his assent to laws for establishing judicial powers, and two, he has made judges dependent on his will alone for the tenure of their office and the amount in payment of their salaries. And my concern is, whether it be retention or otherwise, are we going to have a brand new King George? Is it going to be big business? Is it going to be social issues? Are we going to go back to the way we were? And if the public perceives that, whether it's true or not, are they going to respect the judiciary, the rule of law, and everything else that goes with it? So those are my concerns. And I guess we could talk more about how money affects retention elections, but I'll just stop right there also.
Thank you all. I'm going to open up with a few questions and then give the panelists a chance to ask some questions of their fellow panelists if they have any. It seems to me that one of the issues that we consistently run up against when we talk about these issues is that while the public may be losing faith and while the public may potentially perceive a lack of fairness and impartiality in our courts as a result of campaign contributions, we also know that the public is overwhelmingly in favor of judicial elections. And to a great extent, there seems to be a disconnect between an expectation of majoritarian representation and the notion of what our courts should be. So when we see reports like this, I'm wondering if any of you have thoughts about that tension that exists and the degree to which any potential reforms, any potential responses have to address that tension. I'm going to just open it up. Anybody?
I'll start.
All right.
Michigan, for example, has elected judges forever, and it's the only thing people there know. Obviously, there's the federal system that's there, but they really only know that they get to elect their judges. Now, the fact is, the truth is, a good many, maybe 50% of the judges on the bench at any given moment didn't get there by election in Michigan at all. They got there by appointment by the governor, who had absolutely no control, no check and balance on his choice or her choice, and then ran for election at the next general election, but as an incumbent, hence with a huge advantage. Never mind. The fact remains, the public views it as a state where we elect our judges. They're used to that. It's hard to change what you're used to. Number two, I think many people feel that as long as the system's running okay, they're not going to worry too much about it. And so they don't educate themselves as they should about who the candidates are that they're asked to vote for. But they have in the back of their mind the theory that they can throw the rascal out if they decide somebody's really doing a bad job. And they want to retain the ability to throw the rascal out. Thirdly, I think any effort to educate the public about and force the public to confront what members of the public know full well, and that is that they don't cast informed votes most of the time for judicial candidates. Any effort to confront people with that is met with the opposition by those favoring the retention of elections that scares people into being willing to make a choice. For example, I remember in Ohio, a major effort was made to go from election to merit selection, and the ads that were run on TV showed a great big lock and a key, and it said, "Don't lock out our right to elect judges." And people overwhelmingly voted against changing the system. Those are three reasons, I think.
Yeah, I think it goes more to an education or a basic civics type problem when you go into the grade schools, because one of the things we did after the last election was the election where the three were not retained. We started a very broad public education effort. We hold court around the state now. We do it in high schools. We visit high schools. We do a whole lot of stuff to try to talk to people about what the courts do and what the courts don't. But it reminds me when I was a lawyer and everybody would say the system's corrupt when you try a case, and the jury system's corrupt because you didn't know anything about it. But after someone served on a jury, they'll always tell you it's the best system they ever saw, and it's great. And the same thing with judges. You know, when they go to court, they want someone who's fair and impartial. They want somebody who didn't take money from one side and not from the other side. They want someone to decide the case and the law and the facts, not based upon, you know, who contributed to who. But the problem is most people never go to court. Most people never get involved in the court system. So what they think is that in a democratic society where majority rules on the other branches of government, they need to hold judges accountable for decisions that they make. So I think it's more of a long-term problem of getting back to the area where young people learn what courts do and what judges do and have a little more respect for them, because quite frankly, my generation, it started in my generation and it's kept on going. The courts and the judiciary is not held to the same esteem as they were. You talk to somebody, so when I started practicing law, we had older partners. They were probably younger than me, but they were old when I started practicing law. And all they wanted to do was be judges, and all they wanted to do was get involved in the judiciary. You talk to a lawyer in their 30s, 20s, or 30s, they want nothing to do to becoming a judge. And I just think it's the way the system's perceived rather than what the system is.
I'll just add one comment quickly. Those surveys, which we're all familiar with, I think possibly they're not asking the right questions. And so, yes, the public is concerned about the influence of money, but it's a completely different thing to say they're willing to give up that power of electing judges. And so I imagine if you ask surveys, well, would you rather see the election system tweaked so that maybe there's public financing in these systems, or we have stricter limits than we currently have, or we move to a retention system, which in general is not quite as bad as the most recent situation that my panelists has had to deal with, then though I think we'd see very different answers than we do on just the straight-up question, do you want to get rid of elections?
Yeah, and maybe my role is to play devil's advocate here, and that's okay. But it dawned on me that it may be that there is no tension here, that the public has made a rational choice between what they see as the lesser of two evils. I'm not agreeing with them, but it's possible that what you have is a public that says, yes, campaign contributions might corrupt our current judges, but if we keep elections, I still have the chance to toss them out on their ear. If we go to some other form and the judge is corrupted, because they have a fairly realistic view that anyone could become corrupted by any number of ways. It might be easier through elections, but it's still possible to become a corrupted judge through some other method. And if that happens, then there are no elections. And everyone knows that retention elections, I mean, everyone votes yes, so it's essentially there for good.
Until they don't. With
rare exceptions. those rare catastrophic exceptions. The choice is, do I run the risk of corruption where, maybe a higher risk of corruption where I still have the chance to toss them out if that occurs? Or do I go with the lesser chance of corruption where if it occurs, I'm stuck with it? Right? I think that could be a rational choice. I don't think that there has to be any tension there at all.
Looking into the original history of judicial elections, what Jeremy just said is exactly what people thought. They were worried that the federal system with life tenure just encouraged kind of cronyism and government being able to kind of, if you could... You could essentially, put political hacks on the bench, which would control things, and that elections were the way to ensure that justice was served and that judges remained independent. And so it's very ironic, kind of looking back at the history, is completely different than what most people think today, that elections kind of are in tension with this judicial independence initially. So exactly like what Jeremy said.
And it's a little disheartening working for an organization that will celebrate our 100th year next month. For 100 years, these arguments have been going on and these debates have been going on about the extent to which our courts are being influenced by political, whether they be specific political actors who have an agenda to bring to the court, or whether they come down to, the courts are subject to an uninformed public, or, throughout the course of all, it's been going on for a long time. We're not going to come up with any firm answers, I don't think. Having said that, my next question is, to what extent, and Joanna, you in particular had mentioned the reforms that might help alleviate some of these concerns, and you specifically mentioned public financing, maybe some campaign finance limits. Given some of the legal changes that we've seen governing elections, to what extent do you see some viable reform options here?
I'm not a huge... optimist about the political process, so I'll start there. But in general, we see a lot of states trying to move towards some sort of merit selection, and I really don't think there's one answer that's clearly foolproof. And Jeremy's made a lot of good arguments about different things. And some of my previous studies, I've shown that judges that are appointed by the governor or the legislature they're more likely to favor government litigants than our other judges, so that is potentially problematic as well. There have been other authors who have looked at nonpartisan elections and what do those judges, how do they tend to potentially be influenced? And so there's not really one system that's foolproof. I guess it's just kind of choosing which of the evils you're most comfortable with. That being said, some of the states that have experimented with the public financing, I think have been relatively, and I know, speaking with some of the judges too, have been relatively happy with those kinds of systems, although you still have kind of independent expenditure issues, which are becoming a bigger issue now, especially after Citizens United. So I don't really have, I think, a great answer. Maybe some of the judges would be better to
answer. I was going to say, does anyone else have reform options that you want to?
Well, yeah, I do. I'd like to say, with respect to public financing, it is a wonderful idea. The trouble is, what candidate in the world is going to agree to public financing and not raise money himself or herself if he knows that there are these independent, these 401c4 groups out there who will flood, who could flood the election with their money? They couldn't begin to get enough public money. It would be almost suicidal, it seems to me, for a candidate to agree to public financing, even if it were there.
under those circumstances.
Yeah, I know judges who have, and I think it's kind of a point of pride for them that they can then say that to the voters, that they chose to do this, and I don't know, it's kind of like driving a Prius or something, I guess. I mean, they're not giving in to the, you know, the power of money or something. And so, but I agree. I mean, especially now with all of the independent expenditure and TV advertising, it's a very risky choice to make.
It's a wonderful privilege to be able to stand on that principle.
Right, but
usually
you're right.
People don't have mortgages to pay or children to support when they can do it. In Michigan, I began a task force. It was a bipartisan task force. Senator Dale Connor was the honorary chief. James Ryan, recently of the Sixth Circuit Court, was the other co-chair. He's a Republican, I'm a Democrat. We 24 people on our task force, half Democrats, half Republicans. Came from everywhere. Came from business, came from the legal world, came from the legislative and education world, et cetera. We worked the whole year, came up with recommendations. The biggest recommendation we made had to do with this dark money, and it was the Michigan campaign finance law needs to be revised to encompass that money, to require that those contributions, call them issue ads for issue ads or whatever, that the donors be disclosed, that the amount be disclosed before election day.
You know, we don't have judges who campaign, so we don't. I didn't start a campaign committee. The three who weren't retained didn't have a campaign committee, so there were no monies raised by judges. But in my election and the election before me, there were the group anti same-sex marriage and pro-same-sex or pro-independent courts. They had a different message they were really getting across there. One of the concerns was, where is the money coming from? And most of it was donated by National Organization for Marriage and groups like that. And, you know, people were saying, well, who's giving to them? And I don't think if people knew where the money was coming from, it would really make a difference for people who were voting on those issues. In Iowa, we knew that in the first retention election, it were the early presidential candidates who were funneling money into it. In my election, it was the same thing. Rick Santorum has a PAC, and there were other PACs. So people knew who were behind these PACs who were funneling money into these elections. So I hear all the time that people are going to vote and make a decision on voting as to where the money's coming, you know, follow the money, and you'll figure it out. But I don't think so, at least in a state where the issue is political and a real social, maybe, you know, the death penalty, term limits, same-sex marriage. I don't think people really care where the money comes, because they rather get their issue vindicated one way or the other. So I'm not so sure that disclosing the money is going to do that, at least in a retention state. And maybe it will work in a partisan or nonpartisan state.
Well, there's another thing to be considered, and that is, if the donor can conceal his identity, he can say just about anything, and he isn't responsible for it. Nobody goes back to him. If it's a company, nobody thinks poorly of the company as a result of the fact that that company has paid $1 million to call a candidate a pedophile. That, I think, would slow, if the donor knew that the donor was going to have to disclose who he is, he's going to think twice, particularly if he's got a company, he's making money on that name. He's going to think twice about putting up $1 million to call somebody a pedophile when he knows that everybody's going to know that he did it.
I'm generally cynical about the ability of any reform to work, with relatively few exceptions. And I think the idea of transparency is about the only thing that has a chance of working. The reason I say that is, again, the risk of sounding like a broken record, rent seeking will occur any time power is there, the power to hand out goodies exists, the power that attracts the rent seeking. And it, just to be clear, rent seeking is just, it's an economic term of art. I find it as abhorrent as you do. It's something Gordon Tullock and James
Buchanan. Make it up.
No, Gordon Tullock and James Buchanan came up with it decades ago, and it's just one of those really silly economic terms that those of us who follow the profession are stuck with, because someone came up with it long, long time ago. But the point is that, you know, if that's the case, and we can pretend that rent seeking won't exist. We can pretend that people won't follow the goodies, but they do. And so when we attempt to craft policy responses, if we ignore the fact that rent seeking exists, all we do is funnel the rent seeking in some other direction. We don't get rid of it. And I don't know if amused is the right word, but every time there's some attempt at reform and turns out it doesn't work and everyone throws up their hands and says, well, we've tried everything. And my response is always, but you're ignoring the fact that rent seeking exists. And so, yeah, the rent seeking just changed direction. Well, surprise, surprise. And so I think one of the things that should work at least partially is to require transparency. If people are, transparency is the first step. Make sure everyone knows who is engaging in rent seeking, and then shame them. I think public shame is a far underutilized behavioral modification tool, but that's just me. I'll let you. I have a 4-month-old son. I'll let you all know in a few years exactly how well that worked. But
good luck.
But the point is that the idea of shaming people, making it obvious who's engaging in the rent seeking, and then changing cultural views so that we just don't accept rent seeking anymore. That there's a negative. That there's a cost. Basically, we increase the cost of rent seeking. You know, as the judiciary becomes more involved, the benefits from rent seeking are going to go up, so more rent seeking will occur. The only way you stop that is either pull back on the judiciary being active, or you increase the cost of rent seeking. You have to find one of the two. You have to counterbalance that increase. Either you pull back, you stop the increase, or you increase the cost. Transparency and shame sounds like a good plan to me. I don't know how to implement it, but...
I'm going to open it up to audience question and answer at this point. I'm going to first remind everybody, and for those of you who have done panels before, I assume you've heard this before, but those of you who haven't, first of all, we ask that anybody who asks a question keep it in question form and succinct, and furthermore that you wait for the microphone to get to you before you start talking. So. If anyone has a question, we have one right over here.
Thank you very much. I want to applaud the panelists, first of all, for calling for more disclosure, more transparency, and campaign contributions. I think that's a great step forward. But Professor Kidd, you, and I think to some extent Professor Shepherd, expressed some hesitation with coming out in favor of certain reforms, but shouldn't the goal for any reforms be to minimize the opportunity for rent seeking? It's pretty easy to see how rent seeking takes shape in judicial elections, but if you look at the federal system, for instance, it seems like there aren't a lot of opportunities for litigants or anyone else with an interest in how the law develops to influence how the law how judges issue rulings, but it seems to me like that should be the obvious goal of any reforms. And anytime you have elections in the mix, that's going to be complicated.
Sure. There are three states that give their state Supreme Court judges life tenure, like the federal system. There is a lot of evidence that, although there's not the same kind of forward-looking concern of the judges that, oh no, I need to be worried about my next election, so I need to be worried about how I vote in the gay marriage case or whatever. Nevertheless, we know that there are politics behind who originally gets that appointment. So I would agree with you that I think there's probably, after the fact, there's less, I wouldn't say there's no rent-seeking, but there's certainly less, rent-seeking probably plays a smaller role. On the other hand, the public doesn't want to give up their right to vote. And when you look across the different states every year, there's always calls for different reforms. And I don't recall the last time I saw a call for going to not only an appointed system, but an appointed system that grants our judges life tenure, because that just doesn't seem to be on the table for most. So this is just, I guess, a little bit of the realist in me. Jeremy?
Oh, and I'm even more cynical than that. I think rent-seeking exists in all forms. Appointment systems, the rent-seeking just takes an entirely different form. That's why business community, it's why trial lawyers, it's why all sorts of different people who have an interest in how law evolves contribute so heavily to presidential campaigns, contribute to gubernatorial campaigns in states where there's appointment. Merit selection is a little different, but I think we're fooling ourselves if we think there's no rent seeking involved there. It's just It's rent seeking that's highly confined to the legal profession, which I have certain problems with saying that. I mean, I know rent seeking is going to occur, but as a lawyer saying, but this time only lawyers get to rent seek. That seems self-serving, to say the least. So I'm not comfortable with that. And even if you think the bar association in your state is fantastic and has only the best interests of the judicial system at heart, just imagine what would happen if everyone on your board of your state bar association were elected by your opponents in 1 year. So if you're a plaintiff's attorney, suddenly the defense bar manages to get everyone on the governorship of the whatever your state bar association looks like, and they appointed a whole host of judges that were completely opposed to you, right? That's the type of politics you might see. So that rent seeking occurs everywhere, and maybe I do have kind of a one-track mind, but I see rent seeking everywhere simply because the incentives are there. As an economist, I have to believe, unless my entire existence is a sham, please don't tell my wife if it is, that incentives matter. And we've created, our judiciary creates these incentives. Now, that may be a trade-off we're willing to make, right? Involvement of the judiciary, increasing involvement of the judiciary in shaping, moving away from the Federalist Society model of we'll just look at the law and we'll say what the law is, to a far more active judiciary. That may be a trade-off we're willing to make. We have to understand that's a trade-off we've made. And once we've made that trade-off, we can't simply assume away rent-seeking. It's going to be there regardless because those goodies are there and people are going to be seeking them. The trick is not assume they don't exist. The only way you address those problems is assume they do exist and address them in every possible way. Find the, long-term strategic planning, I guess, assuming that rent-seeking will exist around every corner looking like some terrible evil boogeyman.
I agree that you're not going to get rid of this rent seeking. I mean, when there's a presidential election, the ads, they run these ads in Iowa. They'll start next month for 2 years again. But they start running these ads, he or she will appoint the next two or three Supreme Court justices. You see in the federal system, although there's supposed to be no rent seeking, no one can get confirmed when the other party has some control because they want to make sure that their people get confirmed and who's contributing to the senators' campaigns and the people who make those decisions. In a merit selection system, you're absolutely right. The governor makes the eventual appointment, and the governor, at least in our state, appoints the lay people on the nominating commission who have an equal say as the lawyers on the nominating commission. So you're always going to have it. The question is, do people want to accept it, or is there a way to explain why it shouldn't happen? I mean, but it's always going to be there in one form or another, and I don't think you can write it out.
I quite agree that there are evils in all possible systems, and I agree that there'll be influence peddling in all types of systems, but that's not helpful. It's an observation that doesn't serve any real useful purpose. What we're talking about here are, we've identified some positive evils in the systems that we have right now, some terrible evils, toxic evils. And the question is, what can we do to get rid of them? Or if not get rid of them, at least attenuate their effect to the extent that they don't corrupt our whole system. That's what we should be talking about, not whether, there's bad in everything. It doesn't help.
And I'll add one more thing, too. We all know the idea of the second-term president who has a lot more independence to do things than the first term. And so I think, in general, we agree that having to be reelected has some influence, at least on what anyone may do, presidents, judges, whatnot. I'll also say in some of the earlier studies that I've done, most states have mandatory retirement ages for judges. So you can actually see how they're different in their last term before they have to retire when they can't run for judge again. And we do see a difference in the way they vote. And the money doesn't seem to have as large of an effect. It still has some, which makes me think that the pathway that judges follow money or whatever is important. But the fact that it gets less also suggests that money, I got those confused, sorry. So judging follows money, but also money follows judges, right? But so we do see that in their last term, judges act a little bit differently.
I would be crushed if you could find that I acted differently in the last 10 years before I had to leave.
But you're here, and there's a reason you're on this panel. So.
Liz Kennedy, Demos. I wonder if you could speak a little bit about Caperton, because I haven't heard that coming up yet. And the, you know, the remedy of a recusal is an interesting one. I think, you know, we've been talking about, yeah, rent seeking is everywhere, but as you say, there will always be power. People will always be trying to get closer to it or achieve their own ends. But that doesn't mean we should allow this kind of pay to play that we see. And there are other places where the SEC, for example, has two really strong rules that says the company can choose whether to make contributions to a candidate, but then they won't be able to seek that business's, the business of either municipal bonds, or the same thing now is protecting against pay to play in the investment of pension funds. So you can make that contribution, but you then can't seek the business of the state pension fund investment. So, and I think that that kind of recusal or forced understanding of this pay-to-play relationship should be imported, and Caperton tried to. How can we expand on Caperton?
I've written a bit on Caperton. Do I need to discuss that case at all? Briefly? Okay, so this was a case in West Virginia where, and tell me if I get the facts a little bit wrong, but so there was an incumbent judge running. There was a big coal company there, Massey Coal, who had an appeal pending. Massey starts a group called, I think it was called And for the Sake of Children, that like 99% of the money was Massey Coal money, and paid to have a new judge replace the incumbent. And so the new judge is now on the West Virginia Supreme Court, and lo and behold, when the case comes up, he kind of cast the deciding vote, I guess. He was the one who kind of flipped the other direction, and now Massey Coal, I think it was like a $50 million damage award that he overturned. And so it went to the Supreme Court, and they said when there's an risk of an actual, what is it, actual risk of bias or something like that, then a judge must recuse himself. And so there's been states toying with recusal. The problem is it's not so easy just to say you must recuse. It can't be a black and white rule for the following reasons. In a lot of areas, and especially smaller areas, you have lawyers on both sides who've given to a judge's reelection campaign. And so what? None of the lawyers in town can now argue a case before that judge. You often have a lot of the litigants, especially in smaller areas, who've done the same thing. Similarly, people are concerned about gaming the system. And so if I want to make sure I don't get that darn liberal judge, I'm just going to make sure I give money to his campaign, and then I'll never be in front of him, and I'll get to go to the other judge. And so there's not, you know, states have been tinkering with this and trying to figure it out, but I think that it has to be almost a discretionary rule in some sense. Now, a lot of states have allowed the judge themselves to decide when they should be recused, and maybe that's not the right role. Maybe the other judges on the court should make that decision, and that way you can kind of avoid game. Maybe there's other kinds
that's
of gaming.
What we did in
Is
Michigan.
That what you did?
Yeah.
But you know, so there's problems, obviously, potential obstacles that states will have to deal with when looking at recusal reforms.
Yeah. Now, we rewrote our judicial code of conduct after Caperton. And some of the things we put in there, we followed the announce. If you announce a position, you have to recuse yourself, which who knows if it's still constitutional. But we have that provision in there. But we did, you know, many states have a provision if you give more than X amount of dollars. And in fact, if you look at the model ABA rules, there's a blank there to fill in how much. And we actually decided not to do that and left it up when the amount gets to violate due process. I don't know what language you use, but we left it open because the problem is just what was said here by my colleague here. You know, you give the other side, so you get out. You have all these independent expenditure groups who are throwing all this money in, and if you take away the ability for a lawyer, for a judge to raise money, because they're only going to raise money from other lawyers, basically, who have contacts, you're not going to be able to fight these independent expenditures. So it's a hard thing to do. You more than handcuff yourself when you start doing stuff like that if there is a real contested election. And that was our thoughts. Now, we don't have elections, but that was our thoughts anyway.
We passed a recusal rule while I was Chief Justice and we couldn't come up with an answer either. But we did do this. We required that if a justice refuses to recuse himself or herself because he doesn't believe that he should, the others are, the person seeking recusal can ask the entire court to vote on it. And the entire court can force recusal of that justice if everybody, given the facts, believes the justice either is biased or the appearance of bias is so strong that it isn't appropriate. Due process is violated to allow the justice to sit.
Question in the back.
Hi, for Professor Kidd, you had talked about all sorts of systems being potentially subject to rent seeking or corruption. And for life appointments, it's very easy to see how that would affect the appointment process, who gets the job to begin with. But I'm thinking about some of the justices who hit the Supreme Court who were Republican appointees who began to swing to moderate or even liberal perspectives. Are they outliers, or is it the case that all the rent-seeking and that type of system front-loads?
But I think you see rent-seeking both ex-ante and ex-post, the confirmation process. You see ex-ante rent-seeking in terms of contributions, again, the beginning 2 years before the, or I guess 3 years before the next presidential election about, appoint justice, what was the mantra in the last Republican primary? Justices in the mold of Alito and Roberts for forever. It was Scalia and Thomas, and now it's Alito and Roberts and whatever. Right, so there is that. But that the rent-seeking doesn't stop there, obviously. The rent-seeking can occur post-confirmation as well. And the hard thing is, I don't know whether, a Justice Souter or a Justice Stevens, who may have started out, or everyone may have assumed a certain ideology or judicial ideology, but then shifted to the left, or Supreme Court justices that started out further left and shifted to the right. I don't know whether that's a result of rent-seeking or not, but I do know that rent-seeking pressures are there. And so it's impossible to know for certain exactly whether those moves are the result of rent-seeking, but it's certainly not. I don't think it's necessarily a disparaging comment on any of their characters if over time they were convinced by the rent-seeking efforts. Not all of them are sinister. Not all of them are people, lurking behind doors. Justice, I got some money for you, right? Not all of them are threats. Not all of them are monetary contributions. But that sort of behavior will occur. Concerted efforts to change, to attract goodies from government. Kind of ubiquitous.
I don't know if your premise may be right or sound, because I don't know if Stevens and Souter became more moderate, or they appeared to be more moderate because of the people who came after. I see it in our court that we had some very conservative people appointed after this retention, and the ones who are conservative in our court are now sort of in the middle, but they still think the same. I mean, they're still doing the same things, but to the general public, they seem more moderate. So I don't think you can say they moved. I think you could say they appeared to move because of the contrast between the new people. And I think you got to figure that out.
Were their initial positions, were they, not intended as a disparaging remark, but were they posing as more conservative than they were as a result of the rent-seeking pressures up front? Right? There are a whole lot of ways in which we can, if you're cynical like me, and you can kind of see everything through the rent-seeking glasses that I wear, there's a lot of ways you can see rent-seeking pressures in their appointment, in the change afterwards. So,
in the 24 years I was on the bench, I didn't recall seeing anybody that I thought actually changed colors in the course of his or her years on the bench. I did notice this, that as the court grew far more conservative, as it did after 2000, more people who had an interest in issues that a conservative court might buy would appeal those cases involving those issues, so that there were far more cases that would make a distinction between a conservative and a liberal leaning justice, and those of us who were more moderate tended to look more liberal, merely because the cases we had were calling out the conservative edge.
It's a good point. It's see that happening now.
Can I come to the back over here?
Oh, thank you. My name is Bob Stagman. I'm an attorney by marriage. My wife is an attorney, and I'm actually a retired surgeon. But most of all of our experiences come from Washington State, and we're here from Seattle. But what we have done for many years is to correspond widely with many of our friends, contacts, emails, telephone calls when elections come up, exchanging views and getting opinions, and people getting ours and us are getting that. The area where we've experienced almost universal frustration and ignorance is on judicial candidates. And we've had so many people contact us and say, my God, who am I supposed to vote for in this election? They don't have that trouble with initiatives, with referenda, with legislators, certainly not with the governor, but total ignorance on judicial candidates. And I'm questioning, am I describing a phenomenon unique to Washington State, or is this, if this is true everywhere, the panelists, can they suggest some way in which the public can be better informed on the qualifications and not so dependent on the effect of monetary contributions?
Well, there's a few things happening around the country. Some states, such as Colorado, have independent judicial evaluation committees who evaluate judges, not just at election time, but on an ongoing basis to try to improve them, and then publish reports whether they should be retained or not retained, and things like that. We found out, we're thinking about implementing that, and I think in our next retention election, we're gonna have a trial run on that. It's only the Court of Appeals, so we don't have to worry about it on the Supreme Court. So they're gonna be the guinea pigs. But, you know, one of the things that we found out is that people really don't know what judges do and who they are. So we started, it's sort of a dog and pony show, but it is, you know, we go out four times a year to the small towns in Iowa, into the high schools. We'll go out and have dinner with the townsfolk in these towns. And then we'll hold court actually in the high school at night, you know, from 7 to 9 at night. Then we stay up all night trying to figure out what to do. And then the next morning we go into the high schools in the area. And it seems to have very, very positive results because people get to see what we do and how we do it. And it's amazing. You get 400 and 500 people in these small town gym and auditoriums watching what we do, which is sort of like watching paint dry if you ever watch an appellate argument. And afterwards engaging us, because we have a little cookie reception afterwards and lemonade, and asking questions about what happened and things. And they find out at least we're people and we listen, and we try, when we decide cases where we heard them in those areas, we send them, make sure the newspaper finds out what happens, and there's usually a follow-up on it. So those things could help, but, you know, in the past, people weren't concerned about judicial elections because everybody thought the system was fair, and there's probably about 30% or 40% of people who vote in the general election and won't vote in a judicial election. You know, if they don't know, they just don't vote. Although in recent years, we're seeing just the opposite. If they don't know, they vote no. So those things are happening, too.
I think that's excellent. We've done some of that in Michigan, too, getting out community. My observation is that people don't understand what they're supposed to be asking themselves and the candidates when they're addressing judicial candidates. They want to know how you stand on abortion. They want to know how you stand on gun rights. Those are not appropriate questions to ask a judicial. Right, you ask your legislator that. You ask the gubernatorial candidate that. What you ought to be asking the judicial candidate is, what have you done to improve the courts? What do you think is the greatest weakness in the way our courts function? Do you have a record of getting to work on time? do you have a lousy temperament when you're under pressure and you've got a lot of power? There are ways to get at the answers to those questions that I think people would appreciate if they only understood that's the way they should approach the whole business.
But that goes back to the education part of it, you know, right. Of what people expect the judge to do, and it's sort of anti-intuitive to the democratic process, and that's the real problem.
I'm going to take a moderator's prerogative here.
I feel as though, as a whole, first of all, we have a smart audience in front of us because we've adopted rent seeking very quickly.
Yeah, I used it once.
Everybody used it.
The language has really taken hold here. I also, we have informed, interested, engaged people in the room right now, and I feel as though, as a panel, money affects judicial outcomes. We have a report that says that, and we don't seem to be terribly upbeat about what anybody's going to do about it, or if we should do anything about it. So I'm going to kind of open the floor for a minute and see if you have suggestions for the people in this room and the people outside of this room who are also interested in the issue. How do they get involved? How do they take ownership of these sorts of issues and look for ways to address these potential problems? I'm gonna ask Tom to.
Hi, I'm Tom Hilbink from the Open Society Foundations. First of all, I want to say this has been a great panel. I've drunk alcohol, which people tell me is harmful, and I've avoided things like crack and meth because they're more harmful. But I'm thrilled to know that by your logic. Professor Kidd, it doesn't matter if there's a harm, it doesn't matter if it's better or worse, so the meth is on me at the party tonight, and I'll be handing that out. So I hope you all enjoy it. Yeah, please don't tweet that. So anyway, that's a great,
video.
I love economist logic. So I wanted to say the Open Society Foundations has been supporting a lot of work by groups like One Iowa, and or it's Justice Not Politics in Iowa, which has done a great deal of work to try to get when the Supreme Court is not in session at a local gym, which is an amazing way of educating the public. They're out talking to the public about the role of courts and the ways in which we should be selecting our judges in retention elections or other kinds of elections. And for many of you, whether you're from Iowa or Minnesota, where there's an effort to create a merit selection system in Minnesota next year, there's a coalition, the Coalition for Impartial Justice, which includes both the Minnesota Chamber of Commerce and the AFL-CIO. Not two groups that often break bread together, but on this issue, they say the Minnesota courts are too important to sacrifice to politics. And we're supporting these coalitions in Arizona, West Virginia, Alabama, Pennsylvania, and other states that I can't remember. So if you're interested in getting involved in one of these groups, and it's lawyers, it's community organizations, it's civil rights groups and business groups, talk to me after the panel and I can help connect you with the people who are doing this. But there's a lot of work done to find solutions that are better than the status quo, whether it be judicial public financing or merit selection or recusal reform or public shaming, which I think is another, I like the sandwich board idea as well. So thanks.
I had a question right over here.
Sorry, where was the question?
Hi, my name is Catherine Barry, and my question is, Justice Kelly, earlier to your description of dark money, I agree, but you or anyone else on the panel, how would you respond that if we are going to have elections, that people should be able to express their voice in an election through campaigns? Like, I mean, if we're going to do this at all, people should be able to give money. I just wonder, how would you respond to that?
People are entitled to give money. First Amendment right of speech, right? That's what you're speaking up on. Couldn't agree more. But they can't do it and hide behind a bush. That's my point. And of that, almost $19 million spent on the last Michigan Supreme Court election, 57% was undisclosed. 57%, we're not even sure how much there was, to tell you the truth, but we're pretty sure that there was almost $19 million, and we know that we can't identify the people who gave 57% of it. There's something wrong with that. You don't write a letter to the editor and refuse to sign your name and expect it to be published, right?
Right.
Same theory.
Yeah, I think the gentleman in the first row got it right. You just can't wait till 4 months before an election and try to fix it because it's not going to work. It's a year-round effort. You're gonna, you know, you're gonna have to go out as lawyers or judges or citizens and talk to people about judges, what they do, and how they do it, so they can ask the right question, like Justice Kelly said, not how do you feel about abortion, but how can you make the courts work better. The problem is that everybody has a right to vote for a judge in all the states except three. They can vote for a judge for any reason. I can't tell people why to vote for a judge, and you can't, and you can't. And they're used to voting for a judge, voting for a candidate because of a position they take or because of something they said. And in order to get away from this, I think people have to understand that judges don't operate in the elected sense, because they're not representing you, although you vote for them. They're not representing you when you vote for them. They're taking an oath to uphold the Constitution and the laws of the state. And if they're doing that, you may disagree with them, then you got to change the laws of the state or change the Constitution, not kick out the judge, because at least in a retention state, you're going to hopefully get three people who are going to do the same thing the three who got kicked out did. Now, in an elected state, it might be different. You can get instant results if you know what they're doing. So I think it's important that as lawyers and as citizens that you just don't wait till election time and start raising money the other side. You have to go out day in and day out. And in Iowa, I remember when I was a lawyer, that's a long time ago, but when I was a lawyer, Governor Vilsack is now Secretary of Agriculture, Vilsack, and I, we were involved in the trial lawyers as young lawyers, and we actually started a program called the People's Law School back then, where we would go into the courthouses, have law school for adults, and teach them about the law and do that. And we had it in about five or six counties, but we got busy, and you know, we left the organization and went on to do other things, and it sort of failed. But there has to be those type of programs by lawyers. And maybe the older generation's lost. That's the other thing that always bothers me. You can't teach an old dog new tricks. Can we teach people, you know, that they don't vote for people because of positions, but because of temperament and the way they run the system and whether they treat people fairly? So I think that's really the key. And then you could throw all the money you want on the other side, but what's going to happen is they're going to vote for a judiciary, not for a candidate. And I think that's important.
Hi, just a quick question, kind of stemming from a couple things that a few people have said. What is the panel's perception of the difference in election states for state court positions between partisan and nonpartisan? So do you see a distinction when, you know, as you've mentioned, a lot of people are used to voting on issues or for their party, for example. So are you seeing anything in or any personal experience in nonpartisan states where people are getting elected, maybe in counties, for example, that vote primarily Republican, but they're getting a Democratic judge because of name recognition that's mistaken or something of that nature? Something similar to that happened in Ohio this year, so I'm just wondering what the panel's perception of that phenomenon is.
I'll give the kind of empirical answer since I'm one of the academics. So looking at a bunch of different empirical studies that have examined different kinds of election systems, I would say the general consensus stemming from these different studies would be that in a partisan system, the main thing that matters is the letter behind your name. And in some states, on some ballots, it's color-coded for you, red or blue, to make it easier. And that's what gets you elected, because most people, when they are voting, often just vote straight ticket, right? And so the most important thing is having the support of your party, which means favoring the kinds of constituents or kinds of litigants that your party wants you to favor, right? So I have another study looking at, you know, Republican judges, it's best for them to kind of vote in ways that their party wants, and for Democratic judges, best for them to vote in ways that their party wants. In nonpartisan systems, it's very different. And the studies that are out there looking at nonpartisan systems find that these kind of very politically controversial issues can matter more for them. So the way they vote in an abortion case or a death penalty case or whatever, that can really come back to haunt them, because that's where you see a lot of these attack ads and so-and-so did this and let the
pedophile lives next to the elementary school and look what happened. And they tend to be more, because people aren't just voting for the R or the D. They're voting about what they remember that they've seen in these TV ads. So there's kind of a different, I would say, influence in some sense, but also the way that the money or the different sides end up kind of punishing the judges would be different in the different systems.
Yeah. Not being academic and not studying this, but you talk to people who come from partisan states in Texas, and you hear anecdotally that, you know, when the Democrats are going to win, all the Republican judges now change to be Democratic, so they keep their position and vice versa. And you see that in a lot of, I don't know if you've seen that, but that happens in a lot of states where they do have partisan elections, where when the shift that the judges just change their party because they have the name recognition and get swept in with them. So I don't know if there's much difference between the two.
Well, it may be that there's, I mean, that this makes sense from the tying in with the education points that were made earlier. If you have no idea what you should even be considering, you don't even, most of the public, they don't even know what questions to ask. Like, who should I be voting for? What criteria should I use? And if you, the harder that question is to answer, the less you know about that, the more likely you are to fall back on what works for you in most political races, right? The fact that the judiciary has an entirely different role would make a difference if you knew enough that you weren't relying on that criteria in the first place, right? So I think the lack of education, the educational efforts, I would imagine, would have some impact on that as well. At least they should. People should be willing, should move away from, party voting in judicial elections because they have something else to go off. They have some criteria other than, normally when I go into the voting booth, I vote for Republicans, so I guess I'll vote for the Republicans here.
Yeah, an unintended consequence of those educational thing we found out is that, judges in our states didn't get a pay raise for 6 years. We got our budget cut or static for the last 6 years. Since we started doing this, we're actually getting pay raises, and we got our full budget this year because maybe it's because the state has money, but I think it's because some of the legislators from the smaller towns and small areas, we've become visible to them. So it's had that unintended consequence, which will also improve the judiciary, I think, in the long run, because a third of our clerk's offices are closed days, weeks, and all of them are closed at least one or two afternoons a year, and hopefully by next month we're going to have everything open 24/7. So, because we actually are going to electronic filing through the whole state, so it's going to be a whole different system. But that's one of the unintended consequences of going out there. Not only do you educate the voters, you educate the people who vote for your purse strings, and it's made a big difference.
We only have about 2 minutes remaining, so I'm going to kind of sadly bring the discussion to an end, but I'd like to thank all of the panelists here today. But it's also my job to include the following remarks at the end of the panel. Silent auction taking place on the Capitol Terrace and upper lobby begins immediately following this session.
Is that rent seeking?
That's right. There's also an informal breakout session going on in the California room, and at 6 o'clock p.m., you're invited to join in the presidential ballroom for a view from a bench, discussion with current federal district and circuit court judges. And then today's sessions will conclude with a reception in the Congressional and Senate rooms at 7 p.m. Volunteers are going to be on site to point you in the right direction for all of those things. But again, thank all of you for being here, and thank our panelists. And I would like to heartily recommend a careful reading of the report. I think it's very strong academic, empirical work. It is an incredibly difficult topic to cover, and I think you're to be commended for doing it well. So thank you.